I was already waiting for an opportunity when the most senior doctors, Dr. Malik and Dr. Agamini, are here to give a Dhamma talk about the doctor of the Buddha, Dr. Jivaka. And so today they are here. And I'm not sure if you all know that the Buddha also had a doctor who cared for him and also for the entire monks community. He became famous in whole northern India at the time for his great skill. And he was also one of the 20 greatest Buddhist lay disciples mentioned in the Uttara Nikaya. His special quality was that he was liked by many people. So basically being popular or liked by people because he helped so many people, and probably also because of his inner qualities as noble disciple of the Buddha. And the story of Dr. Jivaka, I think it's the most detailed, continuous biographical story of any disciple of the Buddha, actually, that we have. It's in the Vinaya Pitaka, so most people don't read it because they don't read Vinaya, the monastic discipline, and so they don't come across his life story so much. But the story starts in Rajagaha, one of the largest cities at the time of the Buddha in India. And a prince, Prince Abhaya, is on his way to a royal audience of King Bibisara. And then while he's walking there with his entourage, further away from the path, there is a rubbish heap. And then he sees some crows, some birds. They're interested in something. And so the prince asks the other people, what is that they are surrounded by these crows? And so the people go and have a look and say, it's a baby, Your Majesty. And is it alive? Yes, it's alive. And the prince tells the people who are together with him to bring the little baby to the palace and to give him to the nurses in the palace to bring him up. And so because they said he's alive, he gets the name Jivaka. And because he was given up, he was given to the nurses to bring him up in the palace, he is called Komarabhacca, this is his second name. After a few years, little Jivaka gets old enough to reflect about life a little bit and about things. And so he notices all the other kids, they have a mother and a father. But he doesn't have a mother or a father, he doesn't know. So he goes to the prince and asks him, who is my mother? Who is my father? And the prince says, even I don't know where your mother is, but I'm your father because I have brought you up. And then once he's adult, he reflects that it's not easy to live there, basically in the palace without any profession. And what if you would learn some profession? So there is, at the time, there is a world famous doctor in Takasila. So at that time, Takasila, which is today in Afghanistan, was a big university and center of learning for about 1,000 years, from about 600 BC to 500 Common Era. And so the people could come to study there various subjects, also medicine. And so he decides to go to Takasila, travel far away to study medicine. And he's bright quite person and describes him very nicely how he says he learned much, he learned quickly, he understood it well, and then he didn't forget what he had learned. So a bright student, and he studied medicine for 7 years in Takasila. And then after 7 years he thinks, I'm learning much and I learn quickly and I don't forget what I've learned. But after 7 years, when will I finally finish my study? So this question when that all students ask themselves, the last 2,500 years. So he goes to his teacher and asks him, when will he finally graduate or finish his study? And the medicine teacher gives him a little task. He says, Jivaka, in this case, take a spade and wander around the city of Takasila and bring anything you see that is not medicinal. And so because Jivaka had this great knowledge about medicine, every plant that he would see, he would know he had some medicinal purpose. And so at the end he's wandering around and then he comes back to his teacher and says, I was wandering around but I didn't see anything that was not medicinal. The teacher says, you have finished your studies, this much is enough for livelihood. So this is the final test of the medical profession. It's sent around to see whether there's anything, how much knowledge he has about medicine. And he also gets some small provision. And he's traveling back to Rajada after finishing his study. On the way he's greeting in Saketa, he runs out of his provisions, so he's just in this town of Saketa, which is on the way, he's just looking for people who need some medical treatment so he can earn some more money. And he's treating one person and who's quite rich, and then the relatives will give him some funds, and so at the end he comes back to Rajada with 60,000, I don't know the name of the currency, 60,000 gold coins maybe, and a male slave and a female slave and a horse on carriage. And then so he's arriving in Rajada, and he goes into the prince and he says, he wants him to accept his first the 16,000 and the things that he got as repayment for looking after him. So he wants to repay some gratitude for the prince who brought him up when he was a little child. He wants to offer him the money that he earned. And the prince, made for your own and build a residence inside our palace. So he just accepts him as part of the royal family, and so he has a house or area there at the palace where he can live together with the other part of the royal family. Later, King Bimisara himself is also ill, and Jivaka cures him very effectively. And the king offers him a big reward, but Jivaka declines it and just says, may your majesty simply remember my service. And King Bimisara then says, well, dear Jivaka, may you attend to me and the women in the palace, and the Buddha and the order of monks. And so he, basically, the King Bimisara then appoints recognize him as his own doctor and doctor of the Buddha and the most community. In the Vinaya Pitaka, there's lots of information about medicines and different medical treatments, because the Buddha also laid down various rules regarding different forms of medicine and treatments. So this also gives us a little glimpse. If you got sick 2500 years ago, what kind of treatment would you get in India 2500 years ago? It was not so, as I say, it's more unpleasant than now to get sick, obviously. So this, for example, this whole chapter, we have these two study books for the monastic rules, and this whole chapter on like medicine, and just a few examples, quite a lot of medicines were herbal, so for example, roots or leaves. For example, roots like turmeric is mentioned, or ginger roots, white orris root. So they would use these different kinds of medicinal roots, different treatments. And then also astringent decoction medicine, so like neem tree and this astringent quality, and also leaves, like some herbal leaves which have a medical property, and some helpful for the health. And then for example different kinds of fruit, for example the tripala, these mirobalan fruits, they are also mentioned in the Vinaya. And resin, like gum, like this resin from the trees. Interestingly, I didn't know that it has any medical benefits, but it seems to have. I don't know that much about old, this ancient medicine. And then also salt. So for example, most like pills that we would take now would be classed as a salt medicine. It's very similar like that, which is normal. Yeah, so for example, they say for people having jaundice, like they would treat it with urine and yellow mirobalan. So I don't know whether this is very helpful. if you have, let's say, usually this jaundice is caused by liver, some problems, for example with hepatitis or things like that, and that it helps to take urine, and this fruit is sort of not so questionable, obviously.
Yeah, that's also a question I was going to ask, because you read in Ajahn Chah's book, they use fermented urine.
Yeah, yeah.
So is that in there?
Yeah, it comes in this, again, the Vinaya as well, yeah, exactly. Well, for example, if people have some itch or small boils or sores, then can use some powder to treat it. Or for eye diseases, some ointment for the eyes. Or if people had pain in their heads, they would apply some oil to the head, or give treatments through the nose, like something like that. And but they even did also some operations already. So there is two quite impressive cases. One where, so there is this in Rajagaha, there is a rich banker, and he has already 7 years some pain in the head, and many famous doctors came to treat him, but they just charged a lot of money and for the treatment and left, but didn't help him actually. And yeah, so then it reaches the point where the doctors actually give up on him. And so some doctors say in probably 5 days he will die, maybe in 7 days he will die. And then the people in the city council of Rajagaha, they want to help him because this is an eminent person. And so they ask the king whether he can send his doctor. And so he goes to this rich banker and observes his symptoms. And so he asks him first, if I cure you, what will be my reward? And he says, all my property will be yours, and I will be a slave. I will be your slave. So he's very, very desperate, obviously. But I think they also have an understanding that actually the wealth is basically useless. If you're very sick, you couldn't be able to use it anyway. Like, you're a millionaire, and then if there's someone in hospital and half dead, you can't use the wealth anyway anymore, so it doesn't really happen. So recognizing that. And so Dr. Jivaka asks him, can you lie on one side for 7 months? So not to move and just lie in the bed. Then, yes, teacher, I can lie on one side for 7 months. Can you lie on the other side for 7 months? He says, yes, I can. Can you lie on the back for 7 months? He says, yeah, I can lie on the back for 7 months. So then Dr. Jivaka is tying him to the bed, and he actually he makes an incision in the skull. He drills a hole into the skull, and he says he removes two creatures from the brain-eating creatures.
Oh.
Maybe they thought a brain tumor is some creature, brain-eating creature or something, but I'm not sure. So it says they, not sure about what kind of, how to describe this, but
maybe some worms or something.
Yeah, something, yeah.
I think maybe possible that it's just a way to describe it, because if that thing grows, then they think of that as a creature.
Yeah, exactly.
It could be just a
yeah,
tumor.
Yeah, exactly, yeah, like a tumor. Looks like that's a brain tumor. And so he takes out these two, whatever, things from the brain. And so he said these two things that would have to, basically, would have consumed the brain in 5 or 7 days. And so that's why I was sick. And yeah, so then he closes the hole in the skull and stitches the skin together and applies some ointment. And so then the man, the rich banker, he's lying there for 7 days on one side. And then after 7 days, it's too tough already. He can't continue anymore to lie there on one side for 7 days. So he says, teacher, I can't lie on one side for seven days. I can't, it's just too much. And Jivaka says, but didn't you say you can lie there for 7 months? Yes, it is true, I said that, but I will die. I can't lie on one side for 7 months. He says, okay, in this case, then just try the other side, turn over and the other side. And then again, after 7 days, it's already too difficult for him. And then again, the same process happens, and then he tells him to lie on the back for long. So then after 7 days, lying on the back, it's too difficult for him, and he says he can't stand it anymore. And so, and Dr. Jivaka says, if I hadn't said this to you, like to lie there for 7 months, then you wouldn't have been able to lie there even for 7 days. But he knew beforehand, in 3 times 7 days he would be cured, so now he can get up. And so it was just, he just asked him to prepare him to lie there for a very long time, and 7 months. Then he could make it at least for 7 days. So just a little trick. And so yeah, he keeps his promise and says, all my property is yours, teacher, and I'm your slave. And he says, that's enough. Don't give me all your property, and just give me 100,000 and the king 100,000. And so he got this big income from this banker. Yeah, so it seems they did some brain operations already there in India.
Mm.
Yeah, I think even with some other, in some other cultures, when they noticed they did something with some operations in the skull, how successful is another question, but how long that would have helped the person. But,
yes. It's just that, so that's this connection to Ayurveda, isn't it? Ayurveda with this time, Ayurveda is the word that they used, but it is just coming in this time, the herbal medicines, the salt drop, and then now this system called Ayurveda, like a practice.
Yeah, I think they use some similar, let's say, herbs or medicines. Yeah, for this trip, fruit or this type of thing. Yeah.
Because they use, even in the army system, they use the apotejo, the heat element is high in somebody, and then they give something to cool it down. So all these elements are also being used.
Exactly, they had this, basically, the diagnosed diseases according to the four elements. So let's say some diseases associated with wind element would be, for example, also like sharp pains or like dizziness would be associated with the wind element. So there are different type of classification of diseases than we would have now. To what extent the Ayurveda today is the same as at that time, I don't know, because I don't know how much about them being. But then there are some similarities probably in terms of the basic system of diagnosing with the four elements. This definitely one can see from the suttas that's there. Yeah. So yeah, similar then he does, one also mentioned, he does some intestine operation. So he ties the person to a pillar. you can just so he doesn't move around too much. And then they put a curtain around and it opens the skin of the belly and untwisting the intestines. So, and,
could be appendicitis,
yeah. Yeah. Yeah, maybe. Because of his great skill, Dr. Jivaka's service as doctor became very popular to the point that he had to turn people away. So then people would come to Dr. Jivaka, and it's also from the Vinaya Pitaka, and then they ask him to treat them, and he says, I'm very busy and have much to do, and I have to take care of the king and all the people in the palace, and the Buddha and the Sangha. And so they're very desperate, but this is already too much to do. And so they have a clever idea. They thought, we could just ordain monks to get treated by Dr. Jivaka. So some people then with various diseases, they just ordain with the purpose of getting treated with a doctor. And so after some time, then Dr. Jivaka notices that, and he asks the Buddha, or he tells the Buddha. And so because of that, as part of the ordination procedure, the candidates get asked whether they have certain diseases before they get accepted into the order. For example, let's say leprosy or tuberculosis. And so this is still part of the ordination procedure even today, to get asked whether you have these diseases. Also generally attitude, that one obviously wouldn't be a good motivation to ordain in order to get medical treatment. Just in general.
Yeah, that's interesting, because I always thought that was always questioning why was the Buddha only, you know, like ordained perfect people. You know, if you have any.
No, there were also very like, different occasions where you can see that they actually ordained with some defiant motivation or some actually wrong motivation. And at that time, the Buddha wasn't the only one who would ordain monks. But during the first period, only the Buddha would ordain, and the monks would just bring all the candidates to the Buddha, and he would just ordain people by saying Kompiko. And then it was the ordination. And then afterwards, one time the Buddha is in seclusion and reflects, all these monks bringing these candidates to me, and it's burdensome for them. And they have to bring all these candidates personally to the Buddha to ordain, and what if he would allow the monks to ordain themselves? And the first step is then he allows the ordination by a triple refuge. So basically at that time then all the candidates would only shave their head and their beard and put on the robes, and then they would bow to the monks and just take the triple refuge, just like with the ceremony that we do now. And then it would count as ordination. And then after some time later he would then change it to his formal Sangha Kamma that we have now. So it was a three-step process where it got a formal act of the Sangha, decision of the Sangha to accept the candidate. Before that it was much more informal. Basically just like a little refuge ceremony that we would have here. That was it already, more or less. Mm-hmm. And then later, the Sangha Kamma.
The question about illness, is that just for physical illness? What about mental illness? Was that also asked?
These are only for physical illness.
Right.
So it's not, it wasn't covered or at least not mentioned in this context of the ordination. Yeah, exactly at that time. Yes, yes.
Stability.
Yes.
Being a stable person.
At least just in terms that if one has some psychological problems, that they know about it. Yeah. And also, obviously, with the candidates, then, let's say if they have to live for 3 months or so at the most, various guests, then also notices. Mm-hmm. Usually if there's some major mental problems, one would also notice. But also they get actually asked, even, let's say someone comes as guest to a monastery and thinks about ordaining, then they usually have to fill in some form. They have to, should declare if they have any, whatever, under some treatment.
Yeah. But
actually much even longer, in the sense that, let's say, this first one comes as guest, let's say in England, where I ordained in Chittavibeka, then the people would come to stay as guest for 3 months, then they would become anagarika, so like a permanent, like long-term 8-precept residents for 1 year, and then someone there for another year, so it's actually long time, you get to know the person, and at least to some extent. So it's a much longer, it's a longer process, and also same for them, the people can also reflect about their own motivation and how serious they are about it, and see for some time how it is to live in a monastery in robes before they become a bhikkhu.
Yes. And there is any documentation of the illnesses that Buddha had?
I don't have a whole overview, but sometimes, often it's only mentioned, let's say in the Mahabharata Sutta, one thing is that mentioned that there is some back pain, so obviously some problem with the back. Otherwise, often the stock description is only say a certain monk was afflicted and gravely ill, and then maybe he passes away, but it's not mentioned what exactly. This detail was not so much interesting for them. So most of the time, if people get ill in the suttas or the Vinaya, when it's mentioned, it's just a stock description, and they don't give any details, because in terms of the Dhamma, it wasn't so relevant to transmit what symptoms they had or what the illness was. So one doesn't have so many details. One only sees that in the Vinaya, sometimes some cases, and then there's something mentioned about the treatment or some symptoms. But it's more like anonymous monks who describe, this monk is sick, and then he doesn't treat, applies this or that treatment. Yes.
Even in the Bhujanga Sutra, they say when Kasipa and so on, they were sick, but the exact ailment was.
No, yeah, they usually just take some sickness and then don't give any details, because it's not so. It wasn't really interesting in terms of the Dhamma content. Then they just had this standard description. Yeah, it's just sort of,
So, can you say the cut-off age for ordination?
Not in the Vinaya, no. Like only the same Panana chat, then they maybe with 50 or around 50, depending on how healthy someone is. But in other monasteries, some much older people also attain. So it just, there's no Vinaya rule about the age. And so even if people have this rope, they can ordain several times again. So even that is the age, there's no, all these other obstructing factors, like for example, being in debt or being in the king's service, this type of thing, but not the age.
Yeah, definitely.
Even one can also think about taking care of one's parents without this roaming and just continuing and taking for the parents, taking care of the parents, was think about some other possibility. And
I don't know these Arya Sangha. Mm-hmm. Even if they know they complain.
Complain, I mean, I don't remember the specific occasion of complaining people, but often they would, let's say some monk is ill or some lay person like Anathapindika is ill, and then they would tell a monk, tell the blessed one that I'm ill, and it would be good if the blessed one would come out of compassion. Mm. So basically telling, hoping to get some encouragement by an eminent monk or by the Buddha himself. That happens several times or regularly, that they basically ask for some Dhamma help, in this is Dhamma instruction when they are ill. Yeah, but in terms of, definitely also, they say they, often then the Buddha would come and they ask them first, is your health improving? And then they maybe say, no, it's not improving, it actually gets worse. So this, in the Dhamma, can call it complaining, or at least this day, actually it gets worse and so, yeah.
They would be able to stand the pain a lot more.
I think, yeah, definitely, obviously, the more advanced the practice is, the better they, sort of the less they would be affected by the pain, than up to being a non-vajrayana would be not, basically then wouldn't be affected by the decay of the body anymore in terms of the mind. Before that, it's just free mantra would still be probably to some considerable amount of affected. And another health initiative of Dr. Jivaka was that he suggested the Buddha to allow the monks to have some walking meditation path in saunas for health. So, yeah, it was also some. The time of in India was also considered some health treatment, some sauna with some herbs, and walking meditation paths, like different types of with stone or raised, and or walking meditation halls for getting some more movement. Yeah, this one occasion is in the Vinaya where the Dr. Jivaka is treating the Buddha. And he does it in a also very beautiful way. For example, once he has to give the Buddha a purgative when he's sick. And then Dr. Jivaka thinks it's not suitable that he would give the Buddha some coarse purgative. So he mixes some medicines into the pollen of a lotus flower and offers the lotus flowers to the Buddha to sniff this pollen of the lotus together with the medicine. And so nice, very beautiful way of giving the medical treatment. In addition to all the general service that Jivaka did to the Buddha and the monks, he also offered a whole monastery to the Sangha, Jivaka's mangrove, a little bit further outside Rajagaha, closer to Mount Vajra's Peak. You can also visit, if you visit the holy sites, you can visit Jivaka's mangrove. And also another special thing, Jivaka was the first person who offered a robe to the Buddha. In the early years, the monks and the Buddha himself, they would only wear rag robes made from discarded cloth. And Dr. Jivaka had the initiative to ask the Buddha to allow some new cloth to be offered to him and the monks. So there's even a story that as well. And so at that time another king, King Pashota, he was the king of the kingdom of Ujjaini, which is western India. And so already many famous doctors came to treat him, but they weren't able to cure him. And so King Pashota sent a messenger to King Bimisara because he has heard about Dr. Jivaka and asks him to send Dr. Jivaka to him to treat him especially. So Dr. Jivaka goes to King Pashota and is observing his symptoms. And yeah, so then he tells him that he will give him some ghee concoction as treatment to drink. But the king, he refuses it. He says, ghee is disgusting and loathsome to me, I don't want to take this ghee. Treat me in any other way, it's possible, but I don't want to take ghee. But Jivaka knows this disease of the king cannot be cured without ghee. So he says, what if I were to concoct the ghee with an astringent color and smell and taste? So he doesn't notice that it's actually ghee. So he is concocting the ghee with the various medicines, with the astringent color and smell and taste. So then he thinks, okay, the king will take this concocted ghee and then maybe he will vomit because it's disgusting to him once he takes it. And the king is vicious, maybe he will kill me. So maybe I will take some precaution. So Dr. Jivaka goes to the king and says, Your Majesty, you know, we doctors, we have to dig up roots and gather medicines at just the right time. It would be good if I could just leave the city and come into the city whenever I like, you know, any kind of vehicle or animal I like. And so the king just thinks he gets some medicine and gives him the allowance. And so then Dr. Jivaka gives the king the concocted ghee, and may your majesty drink the astringent. And then after he gives the medicine to the king, he goes to the elephant stable of the king, and he is riding away on the fastest elephant of the king to escape from the punishment of the king. So because the king commanded that he can just go wherever he likes on any animal, so he can even ride away with the elephant of the king, and he just rides away on the fastest elephant. So the keeper Shota takes the drink and digests it, and he actually has to vomit. So, and he says to his people, "This vile Jivaka got me to drink this ghee. Go and find Dr. Jivaka." They tell him he already fled on this fast elephant. But the king still has something in his sleeve. He has a slave who is offspring of non-human beings who can run even faster than the fastest elephant of the king. And so he sends this, his name is actually the Crow Kaka. He sends this this slave to run after Jivaka and get him back. And the king says, "And you know, these doctors have many tricks, don't accept anything from him." So he learned already that he is clever. And so the slave catches up with Jivaka on the road to at Kosambi, and Jivaka just has breakfast. And so the slave tells Dr. Jivaka, "Come, the king orders you to come back." And the doctor says, "Oh, wait a while, Kaka, I will eat. And come eat also something. And the rest." And the slave says, "No, I was commanded by the king. These doctors have many tricks. I don't accept anything from him." on that occasion, Dr. Jivaka is eating a myobalan fruit. And so while he's eating it, he's putting a little bit of medicine into this myobalan fruit with his fingernail to counteract the purgative properties of it, so he can eat it. And then the doctor says, "Eat some myobalan and drink some water. Have something too." And then the slave thinks, "The doctor is eating this myobalan and drinking water. Shouldn't be anything bad." And so he's eating it. And then he's already eating half of this myobalan and is already purged right then and there. And so the slave is worried. Will I live? Maybe give him some poison or something. And then the doctor says, don't be afraid. You will be healthy again soon. And the king as well. But the king is vicious and he might have killed me, so I won't turn back. And he leaves him the elephant of the king and then travels on to Rajagaha and tells King Bibisara what happens. And King Bibisara says, "Yeah, it was good that you didn't turn back. The king is vicious and he probably would have killed you." Then after a while, the medicine works. King Bajota is cured from his illness. And then he sends a messenger to Dr. Jivaka and says, "May Dr. Jivaka come, I will give you a boon. But Dr. Jivaka still doesn't go. He says, "It's enough, Your Majesty. May Your Majesty simply remember my service." But the gratitude of King Pachota is still strong. So because Dr. Jivaka doesn't come, he sends a messenger with some very special pieces of cloth, which are very refined and supreme and foremost and excellent. They sent this piece of cloth to Dr. Jivaka to thank him for his services, Doctor. And then Dr. Jivaka receives this piece of cloth, he thinks the only people who are worthy to wear this refined cloth are either the King Bimisara or the Buddha. And so Dr. Jivaka goes to the Buddha and asks him for a favor. And the Buddha says, the targets have gone beyond favors, Jivaka. And he says, it's allowable and blameless. And so then the Buddha says he may say what favor he likes to request. And so he says, yeah, the blessed one, the Buddha, is a robe wearer, and also the monks. And I have this pair of excellent robes. And may the blessed one accept this pair of robes and allow householders to offer new robe cloths to the Sangha of monks. And in this way, then the Buddha allows the accepting of new robe cloth. So Jivaka was the first one to offer robe to the Buddha. It was a long story for a short, short collection. Yes.
Is that when the system started that we can offer robes to the monks?
Yeah, exactly. Before that they would only collect discarded cloth. And then he asked the Buddha whether people could not offer new robe cloth to the monks of the Buddha. Before that it was just... It was actually similar with the lodgings. At the beginning, the monks and the Buddha would just live at the root of a tree, in a cave, and some charred ground. And then some people see them coming from the forest, and then some lay person asks, if you would offer some lodgings, would you accept them? And they say, the Buddha didn't say anything about it, you even ask the Buddha, and then they go to ask the Buddha and he allows them that they live in some lodging like a kote or allows various forms of buildings.
Ajahn, I was just thinking about the stories from the story of Dr. Jivaka. He's not just a good physician, he's also a good psychologist.
Yeah.
Because he under-promised and over-delivered.
Yeah.
And I think he would make a very good chess player too.
Yes. Yeah, these doctors have many tricks, as they keep a shoulder on this.
Yes.
You know, he gets this banker to lie on the side for 7 days, and then this keeper doesn't want to take his medicine, so I to trick him into taking the medicine. Yeah.
I think nowadays, you know, when I was thinking about, you were talking about the lotus flowers and everything, you know, we also mask our medicine with sugar and artificial sweetener.
Yeah.
The syrups and stuff.
Yeah, make it more attractive.
More palatable.
Yes.
This time there were a lot of Brahmins and flooded. They all go into, they go from house to house.
It was dependent on the person. There were some Brahmins who were actually very rich. They had like a large royal estate and they were living like householders. They had a family, maybe they were doing some ceremonies during some times of the day or some whatever religious subservices, things like that. So some Brahmins lived like householders almost. However, some Brahmins were also living more like monastics in the sense that they actually basically didn't have a large estate or much possessions, but they would just live in seclusion and practice, let's say, Bhava Viharas or meditation. And so from that perspective, there were different sorts of Brahmins. Some were really like spiritual practitioners, some were more like living like householders, so it depended on the individual, we can't generalize.
I heard that they were threatened because of Buddha started voting and so the community, they were influencing the community not to serve Buddha. And so it's just like a, must have been really difficult during that time.
I don't think so. It was already basically the tradition was already before the time of the Buddha that people could leave their usual household life behind and then just live with whatever people offer them basically, and that was part of the people's religious practice that they would offer some food and requisites to these recluses. So basically people had this option to go forth into, into homelessness. That was more or less a normal thing that was happening before the time of the Buddha already. And so people already, there was the tradition that recluses would go on arms round in the villages, and people would offer and support them. So yeah, that was already before that. And so at least the Brahmins, it depended on the how much they went to practice already in household life.
Because in some sutta it says the words recluses, Brahmins, so they are also going to the path, and then, yeah, so he does monks also.
Yeah, also other, obviously, like other followers of other ascetics, then they would also run arms round, for example. Yeah, so it was just normal that that existed.
That was a normal thing during that time.
Yeah, exactly. It was part of the religious background there in India at that time, really. Yeah. After King Bimisara's death, Dr. Jivaka continues to be personal doctor of his son, King Ajatasattu. And as noble disciple, he also has a positive influence on the king. King Ajatasattu then becomes a personal supporter of Devadatta. But then, yeah, at one point, Dr. Jivaka suggests to the king to go to visit the Buddha, and then at the start of that, he takes refuge in Kripaljan. So also, then you can see he has some positive influence on what's happening in the palace there, basically, so that the king of the most powerful kingdom in India at that time then comes a disciple of the Buddha. Then after King Bibisava, King Bibisava was a noble disciple. Then once King Ajatasattu takes over, then yeah, it was only because of the initiative of Dr. Jivaka that he then takes refuge in the Buddha. And by the way, Prince Abhaya, the father who brought Dr. Jivaka up, he also becomes a noble disciple. He wants to listen to another Dhamma talk, becomes a noble disciple as well, just like Dr. Jivaka. And so yeah, then later King Ajatasattu, being a disciple of the Buddha, he then even requests a portion of the relics of the Buddha and builds one of the first 8 relic stupas, and also supports the first Buddhist council in Rajagaha. So he becomes, that's due to Dr. Jivaka as well. The Jivaka's Garden Grove, the monastery, was found by archaeologists in 1954 and yeah, can still be visited. Yeah, so this was the life story of Dr. Jivaka, and yeah, I think it's also nice to reflect if you're a doctor or some health professional. If you do that, you're able to help many hundreds of or even thousands of people. And yeah, with this livelihood, obviously one can create a very powerful good karma. If you help so many people, say if you're a doctor for, you know, 50 years, then you help all these people. So a powerful good karma, just like killing or harming human beings is a very serious bad karma, which leads to body death or sickness. So in the same way, Obviously, if you save people's lives or if you help the health, then it's lots of combination of good karma.